forever we'll sing, forever we love you. We sing, forever we sing, forever we sing, forever we love you.
Make it personal.
I'll sing, forever I'll sing, forever I'll sing, forever I love you. I'll sing, forever I'll sing, forever I'll sing, forever I love you.
Oh Lord, we love you.
It is for me and about me.
The Lord would say unto you, my children, I'm about ready to expand your tent stakes. I'm about ready to expand your tent stakes, not only corporately, but individually. This is your year of more, and I'm going to bless you in ways you never dreamed I could. In many ways, many of you think too small. I am a big God, and I'm going to do big things, not only here in this ministry, but also in each one of your lives, if only you will believe. If only you would believe, I can do it. For there's nothing too hard for me to do, saith the Lord. So think big. Think much bigger than you ever dreamed, because I'm about to do some stuff in your lives that will just absolutely blow your mind. And I'm going to move quickly to do so. Yes, I'm moving the tent stakes in this ministry, both this way and that way. I can do that, saith the Lord. I'm a good barterer, and I can barter for you. Just know that, saith the Lord. So just move in what I'm telling you to do. Seek what I'm showing you, and I will bring it to pass, saith the Lord. For I'm expanding this ministry and each one of your lives, saith the Lord. Don't ask me how you're going to do it. I'm going to do it, and it won't be the way you think I will, saith the Lord. Because I'm a big, big God, and I'm going to do wonders. Wonders that'll make you wonder. Wonders that'll make you wonder, saith the Lord. So get ready, get ready, get ready. Because it's coming even now, saith the Lord.
Praise you, Father.
Praise the Lord. I say, let it be to us as he has said. I said, let it be to us as he has said. Thursday night, we had our healing prayer service, and I felt led at one point to go up here, and I was laying hands, decreeing and declaring on 2017, the year of multiplication. And I heard the Lord loud and clear. In the first part, he said three times, he said, if I said it, I will do it. If I said it, I will do it. He said it again, if I said it, I will do it. Then he finished it with expect it and receive it. Expect it and receive it. Expect it and receive it. So again, if he said it, he'll do it. We need to expect it and receive it. Every promise in his word, he watches over to perform it. Every genuine prophetic word that he's spoken over you or that his Holy Spirit has spoken to you, if he said it, he will do it. If he said it, he will do it. If he said it, he will do it. Now expect it and receive it. Expect it and receive it. Expect it and receive it. And I'm expecting God to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that he can ask or think. It's according to his power that works in us. Eddie shared with me before service all week, he kept hearing that I needed to think bigger and enlarge my tent. John's been saying the same thing. The word came forth today, it's been confirmed. So we need to take the lid off, not just where this ministry is concerned, but in your own life. Well, God, you can only touch me this way or heal me this way. No. Take the lid off. Well, God, you can only I'm on a limited fixed income. No, that's a broke income. Take the lid off. Quit limiting how God can bless you, how God can minister to you. If he said it, he'll do it. Expect it and receive it. I want to get into the word this morning. We'll receive the offering at the end, so remind me if I start to forget or do forget. We do have February's calendar sitting back there, so you can grab one of those as well. But this is part two of the message I started last week on the year of multiplication. The year of multiplication. I'll do a quick recap and then pick up where we left off. And again, I want to welcome all of our Facebook friends and family. You'd be amazed how many people watch on Facebook, whether they watch it live or they go back and watch it later. There's some, they'll come up, they'll blah, 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 blah. They'll get on there. It's hard to preach drunk. Jesus. Some that'll get on there. I don't have a church like this within an hour or 2 hours drive, so thank you for airing these services. Amen. And oftentimes they don't even get the best part. A few weeks ago I turned it off at the end of the message and we had a powerful altar call time of ministry and I'm like, man, should have left it on. So I'm leaving it on, glory to God. Amen. But Job chapter 8. This was our opening text. Verse 5. Whew,
I'm jacked up.
Hallelujah.
Hold on a second. Devil, take that bronchitis. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Had to release some of that energy or it'd be too much for y'all. Job chapter 8, verse 5.
The people like it.
Can't make this stuff up. I don't sit here and I think I'll run around today or Charlotte will do this morning. No, it's whatever Holy Ghost wants to do. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's with so-called knees without cartilage. So Job chapter 8 verse 5 says, if you would earnestly, you got to earnestly seek God and make your supplication to the Almighty, if you were pure and upright, surely now He would awake for you and prosper your rightful dwelling place. Though your beginning was small, hello, yet your latter end would increase abundantly. Talking about multiplication. God is getting ready. And I mean, get ready. God is getting ready to increase you abundantly. Why? Because He's beginning to multiply. Again, we got that word by John first Sunday this year. It was personally to us, but guess what? What God does for us, He does for you. You just got to receive it. And He said, God's getting ready to multiply everything in your life, everything in your ministry, everything in your finances. I don't know about you, but I'm ready for it. So we got to earnestly seek God. We can't be playing. He doesn't, again, and He won't let go of this or let me keep getting on it. He doesn't want your lip service. He doesn't want my lip service. He wants all of our heart. And it's out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaks. Well, I didn't really mean that. Well, you said it. Okay, I'll get off that. But if you would earnestly seek God, make your supplication to the Almighty. Your supplications to Almighty God. It's not to Buddha. It's not to Muhammad. It's not to your pastor. It's not to anybody else but to God. You make your supplication to God, the Almighty, the one true God. And God will move mightily on your behalf.
Amen.
Hoping to get it together next week. Well, I got to download or set it up on the laptop. But I got like a 7-minute clip with Rob, who I'm going to India with. And it's a clip when he was there a few years ago. Massive amount of people getting saved. Did the thing, people coming up, tumors left, cancer left, blind eyes open. Getting ready to go there and going to see it and going to experience it up close and personable in Jesus' name. But again, the Lord gave us a promise concerning multiplication. For that to happen, we got to do our part. You earnestly seek God. You make your supplication to the Almighty. And to sum it up, you got to live pure and upright. And again, we know it's not about legalism. It's not about a bunch of laws, rules, and regulations. But you still got to obey God. The willing and obedient will eat the good of the land. He wants our obedience, not our sacrifice. And anything He's commanded or told us to do in His Word or will speak to you, He may tell you to do something that He's not somebody else. See, too many times we want to be messing around in other people's business. Well, you should be doing this or you shouldn't be doing that. No, don't worry about your own backyard.
Amen.
But the Holy Spirit, again, will not lead you to do anything ungodly or unholy. And anything He commands you to do or leads you to do, He will equip and empower you to do it. When He says, lay aside every weight and sin so you can fully run your race, He's going to empower you to do it. You just got to be in submission to Him and willing to do it. And as we do that, He will prosper our dwelling place. What's our dwelling place? As a corporate body, it's here.
Yes.
For now. Wherever you live individually, He'll prosper you in your dwelling place. shared out of Deuteronomy 8. I'm going to read this one again, and then we'll get to some of the others. Deuteronomy 8, verses 10 through 14. When you have eaten and are full. Again, none of this speaks of lack, church. When you have eaten and are full, then you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land which he's given you. He's not done giving us good land, church. I said he's not done giving us good land, church. Beware that you do not forget the Lord your God by not keeping his commandments, his judgments, and his statutes, which I've commanded you today. Lest when you have eaten and are full, and have built beautiful houses, and dwelt in them, and when your herds and your flocks, multiply, and your silver and your gold are multiplied, and all that you have is multiplied. Talking about multiplication, church. All that you have is multiplied. When your heart is lifted up and you forget the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. In the middle of all that, he's talking about increase and multiplication, but it's a warning. Don't forget the source of it. Don't forget where it came from. Wherever you are today, you don't have to stay there. Where we are as a church body, we don't have to stay here. God will increase us. God will multiply us as we obey him, serve him, worship him, seek his face. But we can't forget where it came from. We can't forget our source.
Amen.
I shared in the very beginning, God was about multiplication. In John 1:28, God blessed them. Speaking of Adam and Eve, God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. The angel came to Sarah in Genesis 16, verse 10, and said to her, I will multiply your descendants exceedingly, so that they shall not be counted for multitude. Shared out of Exodus 7, 3, this was when God was using Moses to call his people out, to set them free from bondage. And he says in Exodus 7:3, I will harden Pharaoh's heart and multiply my signs and my wonders in the land of Egypt. God isn't done multiplying his signs and his wonders. I don't care what these religious, traditional, whitewashed tomb full of dead men bone religious people say. God's not doing that anymore. We have the canon of scripture. We have the Bible. It's complete. I think people still need saved. People still need healed. People still need delivered. People still need baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. The body of Christ still needs edified. We still need the nine gifts or manifestations of the Spirit. God hasn't ceased doing it. Well, brother, that one verse that says tongues will cease when that which is perfect has come in the Word of God. This is what they say, and the Word of God is perfect, so we don't need tongues anymore. It also says knowledge will cease. So I guess in their case, it has. If knowledge hasn't ceased yet and the need for it, neither is tongues, neither is prophecy, or any of the other gifts of the Spirit. That was free. And again, I get it. He was multiplying the signs and wonders to get their attention. Well, signs and wonders still are to get people's attention. But God is still performing miracles, healings, signs and wonders, and he's going to multiply them. Again, I thank God for what he did last January 10th, the miracle in Emma's body, but I'm believing for more multiplications of it. I thank God for all the healings and miracles during that three-week outpouring we had and that have continued. But there's more. I said there's more. And we're going to see a whole lot more signs, wonders, and miracles. Man, I've spent most of this week, got YouTube where I can watch it on TV now and all that. And I looked up Robert Salardin. I don't know how many of you are familiar with him, but he wrote the God's Generals book. So he's got videos of all these past generals of the faith and revivalists. I've been watching them. Man, been firing me up. But some of you think we've had persecution? Got one of them, a woman. I mean, there's still people that, yeah, women's still supposed to preach, still talking that nonsense. But Maria Woodworth Eder, or Eddie, whatever, Eder. Woman preacher, went to California, set up a tent. The religious came against her. The city came against her. She's having these meetings. You couldn't do this today, at least I don't think you can. Had people would go to the insane asylum, take people out of there and bring the crazy people to her meetings to try to interrupt them. Do that. Then during these same meetings, he called them thugs, would come out and they'd cut all the ropes so the tent would cave in on all of them.
As she's preaching,
she still kept preaching. In the middle of that, her husband ended up having an affair. Left her. Had a man, came to the service, and she kept on. And the cool thing that Robert Slayer shared, and it was awesome, he said the one thing about these old timers, they didn't know how to quit. Too many today, it gets hard, well, God must not be in it, and they quit. No. She continued on. Then said there was a man that came, this was at the same time, came and was mocking, making fun of her, and she kept warning, God's going to judge you if you don't stop. He kept on harassing her, mocking her. God's going to judge you. Finally, she said, God's judging you. His tongue swelled up, was hanging out of his mouth. I was like, see that? He's going there. His friends are saying, you need to go back to that woman and have her fix you. First, he then did it. Finally, he goes back and he gets her attention. She's like, what do you want? He goes, you need to fix this, or something along that line. She goes, I'm not doing nothing unless you repent and give your heart to Jesus. He comes down, she leads him in a sinner's prayer, then smacks him upside the face, and his tongue goes back to normal. Woo! Signs, wonders, miracles. Man, I love watching all these testimonies. There's one they showed a video clip of, and I didn't know this, but A.A. Allen, but R.W. Shambach introduced him, and he was young. I never knew that they were tied together, but what God did back then, he can do today, and he's still doing today. We'll allow him to and want him to. Watch one concerning the Azusa Street revival. Went on for 3.5 years, every day. Had meetings every morning, every night. And I loved it. Robert shared this. He goes, again, he said, morning and night, every day, 3.5 years. He goes, y'all say you want revival? He goes, you don't want revival. You just want a weekend visitation where you have your Friday, Saturday meetings and God just visits you and then you go on with your life as normal. Ouch. Some of y'all quit watching that stuff. Get you too fired up. No. I want multiplied signs, wonders. Not for signs and wonders' sake. I want to see people saved, healed, set free, delivered, set on fire. Psalm 107, verses 36 to 38. It says, there he makes the hungry dwell, that they may establish a city for a dwelling place, and sow fields and plant vineyards. Why? Just for the fun of doing it? No. That they may yield a fruitful harvest. He also blesses them and they multiply greatly and he does not let their cattle decrease. That covers every area. You sow, you plant, you'll yield a fruitful harvest. He blesses them, they multiply greatly and he does not let their cattle decrease. Again, anytime these scriptures we're reading about animals and all that, that's for food, but it's also for income. So whatever you do for a living, can you consider, I ain't got no cows or camels or sheep. But you got a job. You got a resource. God's our source. Too many of you look to your job. Or too many look to the government as their source. No, that's a resource. And the government, by the way, should only be a temporary resource. Not a lifelong source. God's our source. Ezekiel 36, 10 and 11. You can turn there. Ezekiel 36. Verse 10 says, I will multiply men upon you, all the house of Israel, all of it, and the city shall be inhabited and their ruins rebuilt. As I was reading this, and again, I know he was speaking specifically to them, but there's things that we can glean from it that the Holy Spirit can teach us and speak to us personally. Multiply men upon you. So I say this, I will multiply men upon you, all of the firehouse church, and a city shall be established and the ruins rebuilt. God's the one that's going to bring the increase and multiplication of lost souls into the Firehouse Church. God's going to bring the hungry, the thirsty, the desperate, those that don't just want a visitation, but they want God to make a dwelling place. They want revival. Yes. Yes. They want the Holy Ghost of God to move however He wants to move. I refuse to try to put Him in a back room. Well, if you want baptized in the Holy Spirit today, come line up and I'll have a couple of my elders walk you back in that other room and they'll pray for you because we don't want to freak any seekers out. Ain't never going to do that here. I didn't see it and don't see it in the scripture. They preached, the Holy Spirit fell, came upon them wherever they were at. In a building or in the street. Why we get so timid and shy and quiet? I don't see them ever worried in scripture about freaking out, offending man. Amen. I'm more afraid of offending God.
Yeah.
And if we quench the spirit, He can very easily say, okay, you don't want me here?
Yeah.
I'll go down there.
Amen.
Well, we want Him here, Firehouse.
Yeah.
I said, we want Him here.
Yeah.
So Holy Spirit, multiply your fire.
Yeah.
Multiply your glory. Multiply your signs and wonders.
Yeah.
Again, bring in the men and women, the children, the youth, the young adults. Bring in those that want more. Verse 11, I will multiply upon you man and beast. They shall increase and bear young. I will make you inhabited as in former times and do better for you than in your beginnings.
Amen.
Doesn't matter your background. Doesn't matter what's happened in the past. Doesn't matter what you may have lost. We're in a new day, new season, and God's multiplying.
Amen.
We've lost stuff over the years, gained some back, but I want it all and more because when God restores,
yeah,
it's better than it was before. I'll make you inhabited as in former times and do better for you than at your beginnings. Then you shall know that I'm the Lord.
Amen.
Still in Ezekiel 36, but verse 29. He said, I will deliver you from all your uncleanness. Go take a bath. He's talking about sin. I will call for the grain and multiply it.
Yes.
Provision. And bring no famine upon you.
Yes.
Again, it doesn't matter what happens out there in the world. In your city, in this state, this nation, or whatever. I'm not in covenant with our government. I'm not in covenant with man. I'm in covenant with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm in covenant with Jehovah Yireh or Jireh, however you want to pronounce it. The one that makes every provision to be seen. The one that said, if you seek first my kingdom and righteousness, I'll add all these things unto you. The one that said, the Apostle Paul said, my God. Ha! He's my God. Shall supply all your needs according to His riches. See, some don't think they're anointed, or you're anointed, unless you do that. Praise God. Hallelujah. Can you say baby? Woo. Verse 30. That's right. Church were a cemetery, I wouldn't be going. Church I was raised up with, the church of, I won't name it, it's rare. But the blank church of C&E, Christmas and Easter. I never felt nothing. But again, my first encounter with God was in Korea.
Yeah.
In the army.
Yeah.
In a guard shack.
Yes.
And then in a rec center with a bunch of spirit-filled men.
Yeah.
When I didn't even know what that meant.
Yeah.
And God lit me up.
Yeah.
Verse 30. I will multiply the fruit of your trees and the increase of your fields so that you need never again bear the reproach of famine among the nations.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Turn with me to 2 Corinthians. It's right after 1 Corinthians.
Yeah.
That was for Greg. Ooh. He knows I'm joking. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. We'll back up to verse 6. Then after this, we'll take up the offering. No, I'm kidding. We'll still receive it at the end, but hey, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word.
Amen.
Verse 6. But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. He who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So then each one gives as he purposes in his heart. So you can purpose in your heart. Are you going to give sparingly? Or are you going to give generously? What kind of harvest do you want? Oh, you're not to preach that give to get stuff. No, I give out of my love for God and support of the kingdom. But no farmer is going to go out and put seed in the ground and not expect to receive a harvest. So when I give, when I sow, I expect to receive. Why? So God can do the rest of what these verses are saying. So let each one give purposely, or give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. We preached a few years ago, preached at a predominantly African church in North Columbus. And it was a weekend meeting and all that. And they received the offerings. Man, they'd play this crazy wild music. And people would literally be dancing up, doing all this as they're giving. I'm like, praise God, that's good. Then I saw a video on it spread all over Facebook of some guy totally trying to draw attention to himself. But he's doing all this crazy stuff to give and then falls down and is a little over the top. But God wants us to give cheerfully. Again, that's why I won't arm twist, won't manipulate. I'll give you the word. I'll share testimonies. Because God has not failed us. When we've given out of obedience to Him, He has blessed us. Doesn't mean there hasn't been challenges, haven't had cars that needed fixed. Man, in December, had to replace 2 car batteries in 3 days. Had plumbing issues that were way beyond what we thought they were. Guess what? Haven't gone hungry. Haven't got kicked out of our house. Utilities haven't got shut off. He's still our source. Verse 8, and God is able. Say, God's able. Doesn't matter what your need is. God is able. We need a building and a land. God is able. You need a job. God's able. You need an increase in your job. Ha! God is able. God is able to make all grace abound towards you. I read that and I picture an animal, but it's a good one. Abounding, lunging. That's what grace is, abounding, lunging towards you. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you that you always, it's time that we get there, always having all sufficiency in all things. All things, church. May have an abundance for every good work. And again, when I talk about biblical prosperity and God blessing you and expecting to, when you sow, you reap, I'm not talking about just heaping it upon yourself. It's so that you can abound for every good work. That when a brother or sister, a family member, whoever has a need, God's able to use you to fulfill it. Again, if I'm broke and all that, how can I help somebody else? But if we're blessed financially, if we're prospering financially, when there's a need, we can help meet it. And I don't have to live in a hut and ride a bike in the process. Some people want to spaz out what kind of houses preachers live in or cars they drive. I can live in a hut and ride a bike. May help feed or clothe a few poor people, but Jesus said you'll always have the poor among you. And then it's gone and I'm still riding my bike and living in a hut. So I'm going to live where I want to live and I'm going to drive what I want to drive. And if God ever says give it away, live in a hut, ride a bike, guess what? I live in a hut and I'll ride a bike. But my wife don't hear him saying that. I'm the head of my house, but she's the neck that turns it. I wear the pants in my house, she just tells me which one. I had her on her knees the other night begging. She said, get out from under that bed and fight like a man. Y'all know better than that. Alrighty then. Verse 9, as it is written, he has dispersed abroad. Is he talking about women there? I know, I was doing good till that point. Alright, back to the word. He has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now this is it. Now may he who supplies seed to the sower. Who's he supply seed to? The stingy? Does he supply seed to the stingy? What's a sower? One that consistently sows seed. A sower isn't one that, well, I sow in January, then I don't sow again until December. A sower is consistent sowing, consistent giving. Now may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food. That's good right there. He gives you seed to sow and he provides you food. He takes care of your needs. Now may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food supply and what? Those of you that are there. Multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness. See, you don't have to worry about, well, if I continue to sow seed, I got bills and I got needs. And I know he'll multiply your seed. He'll give you more to sow and he'll bring the increase. And that isn't just for this year, because we're talking about the year of multiplication. Then he goes, and increase the fruit of your righteousness. 11, while you are enriched in everything, for all liberality which causes thanksgiving through us to God. I believe it's the New International Version, and that verse says that you may be rich. I know that's a dirty word in some churches. It's not here. So that you may be rich, so that you can be generous on all occasions. That's what true biblical financial prosperity is about. Nothing wrong with you being wealthy or rich. It's you chasing it.
Right.
It's you being stingy with it. It's you hoarding it.
Come on. Right.
Anybody that I hear preach, teach concerning it, that God's blessed, they share the testimonies. I've given cars away. I've given houses away. I've given clothes away.
Right.
And it's, you can't outgive God. I've heard Jerry Savelle, I believe it was, say years ago, one point he gave tie away and all that and shared a testimony. Now he got more ties than he knows what to do with. I'm not saying I need ties. Cars, houses, yes. No. But you can't outgive God. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 13 says, for when God made a promise to Abraham because he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself saying, surely blessing, I will bless you. I say, I receive it. And multiplying, I will multiply you. See, this is where some of you miss it. And so after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. Bible says elsewhere, it's by faith and patience we inherit the promise. I can preach and you can get all fired up, multiplication, increase and all that. Doesn't mean it's happening today. Doesn't mean it's happening tomorrow or next week. But you hold on to it. And if you'll patiently endure, you will obtain the promise. You get even... Sometimes it's bad being a part of the pastor's family, I guess. But, you know, last year, and it's the Lord. I don't try to drum up prophecies, especially for family. But a couple times last year, the Lord had me prophesy some powerful words over Jenna and John about increase and God's breaking through for them and all this. And, I mean, they're still fighting some of the sickness in the kids and some financial difficulties and all that. Jenna's like, can you pray and ask God when? I can, doesn't mean he's necessarily going to give me an answer. And this isn't shaming her or nothing. We've all been there, done that. And 9 times out of 10, this is personally, when somebody's given me a word with a date, it doesn't happen. I'm not saying don't give dates if God's giving you dates for people, but the majority of the time when somebody's put a date stamp on a prophetic word or something, that I'm believing God for it, but that day comes and goes. Doesn't mean that promise doesn't get fulfilled, but too many times we get focused on dates and because we got needs and we want our breakthrough and all that. Well, again, if God said that, and I believe he did for them, he'll do it. But as they patiently endure, they'll obtain the promise. As you patiently endure, you'll obtain the promise. And the multiplication of everything that you're believing God for, that we're believing God for as a church body, he's going to do it. Said he's going to do it. If he said it, he'll do it. Expect it and receive it. After he patiently endured, he obtained the promise. Few somewhat quick stories concerning multiplication. Turn with me to Matthew 14. Y'all bored yet?
Yeah.
No. Okay.
Preach it.
You on Facebook? You bored yet? What's funny with the Facebook, you do them live and some people are watching it live and some people go back later and watch it. And then somebody will respond later watching and it's like, I'm no longer there. I'm not talking to you anymore. Doesn't mean it doesn't apply, but they'll answer. Like there's one time I thought it froze up and I'm like, looks like it's the internet froze up. Is anybody on there? Let me know if you're still on there, if you can still see me or whatever. So those that went back hours or days later and watched that same video, because it'll put the time on or whatever, and you'll know, and they'll say, you're still here, I see you. And it's like days later, no, I'm not still here. So that's funny. Matthew 14. Again, we're talking about multiplication. Matthew 14, verse 13. I'm not going to go back and read it, but the heading of that chapter starts out with John the Baptist being beheaded.
Yeah.
And the lesson we can learn, I've got on this before, Jesus withdrew to a lonely place, so I'm sure he wanted to be left alone. He was his cousin. But yet because the throngs of people came, he didn't say, I'm in mourning, I'm grieving, leave me alone. No, he ministered to him out of his compassion. It's a lesson we can learn. So in verse 13, it says, when Jesus heard it, well, I already kind of mentioned that, but he departed from there by boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the multitudes heard it, they followed him on foot from the cities. When Jesus went out, he saw a great multitude. He was moved with compassion for them. And healed their sick. When it was evening, his disciples came to him saying, this is a deserted place. The hour is already late. Send the multitudes away that they may go into the villages and buy themselves food. There's compassion, isn't it? But Jesus said to them, they do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. See, oftentimes when God tells you to do something or tells us as a church to do something, in and of ourselves, we don't have the sufficiency to do it. But with Him, we do. Amen. When He multiplies it, we can. Amen. They said to Him, we have here only 5 loaves and 2 fish. He said, bring them here to me. Then He commanded the multitudes to sit down on the grass. Again, faith without works is dead. There needs to be a corresponding action. He took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, looking up to heaven. He blessed and broke and gave the loaves to the disciples, and the disciples gave to the multitudes. So they all ate. Say they all ate.
All ate.
And were filled, and they took up 12 basketfuls of the fragments that remained. Now those who had eaten were about 5,000 men besides women and children. Out of what? How many loaves? How many fish? But when God multiplies, when God blesses, when God increases, there's more than enough. I said, there's more than enough. There's 12 basketfuls left over. How many disciples were there? Let that one sink in. Who do you think got those 12 basketfuls? Talking about multiplication. Okay, turn with me to 1 Kings. Before 2 Kings, Greg. Why are you picking on Greg? Because he laughs and turns red and he's funny. Now, sir, I'm making fun. I'm making fun and I'm having trouble finding it. Here we go.
He likes attention. What
Kings? 1 Kings. Chapter 17. Again, we're talking about multiplication. Verse 12. No. Back up a little bit. 8. Kind of need to lead into it so you know what's going on. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This was Elijah. Saying, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. So he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, indeed a widow was there gathering sticks. Wow, what do you know? And he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. What a greedy prophet. Jeez. So he said to her, or she said, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I'm gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. Wow, that's some faith right there. And Elijah said to her, do not fear. Go and do as you have said, except die. No, I threw that in there. Do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but make me a small cake from it first and bring it to me, and afterward make some for yourself and your son. Greedy prophet, jeez. For thus says the Lord God of Israel. Again, if God said it, he'll do it, church. I'm not talking about those that manipulate and all this stuff. Give me 20 bucks seed and I'll prophesy over you. That's garbage. I said that's garbage. And they're out there. They'll prophesy. They'll give you a prophetic word for X amount of money. That's garbage. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. So she went away and what? Did. She did according to the word of Elijah, and she and he and her household ate for many days. So much for eating her little cupcake and water and dying. She got a word from the Lord through a prophet, did what he said, and God did what he said he'd do.
That's faith right there.
The bin of flour, verse 16, was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord which he spoke by Elijah. Amen. Again, if God said, I'm not talking about some goofy false prophet or prophet lying. Talking about genuine prophesying. When it's God, when God speaks, he'll do it. Again, do we but truly believe? We'll say it. Jesus Christ, same yesterday, today, and forever. But do we really believe it? By the words that come out of our mouth, by the things we do, by the way we live our lives. Well, I know God did that back then, but I don't know now. We used to have a friend years ago. Preacher said one time she had a bunch of people come over to her house after a service or whatever, had ordered some pizza, but more people came than what she thought. Naturally, wasn't going to be enough. She prayed over it, ended up, everybody ate. And there was a lot, and pizza just kept appearing until everybody was full. This wasn't back in Bible days. This was, I don't know, 10, 15 years ago probably. Are we going to believe it? Are we going to believe that God can multiply what little we have in whatever area of our life? Turn with me to 2 Kings. No, 3rd. 2 Kings, chapter 4. And this is with Elisha. Not Elijah, but Elisha. The one that got a double portion of Elijah's anointing. Amen. He said, a certain woman of the wives of the sons of prophets cried out to Elisha, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord, and the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves. So Elisha said to her, what shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house? And she said, your maidservant has nothing in the house but a jar of oil. Then he said, go borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors, empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. Right, there's enlarging your tent, enlarging your vision, thinking big. And when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you and your sons. Then pour it into all those vessels and set aside the full ones. So she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. Now it came to pass when the vessels were full that she said to her son, bring me another vessel. And he said to her, there is not another vessel. So the oil ceased. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, go sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons shall live on the rest. She only had one jar. Told her to go get a bunch of empty ones. And guess what? The oil kept coming. That's multiplication. That's what's increase. Again, if we'll hear from God, if we'll hear from God, whether it's through another or whether it's you in your own secret place, but you hear from God, regardless of how ridiculous it sounds, regardless if that's all you got, but you do it, God will bless you in it. He'll multiply it. He'll bring the increase. There's several times God's had us give here, give there, do this or that, when in the natural it didn't make sense. And again, every time without fail, God has come through for us. And I'm not setting you up to try to twist your arm and get more the offering out of the end. I want you to believe God for multiplication and increase. Not just for your own life, but for us. We can only do what God wants us to do if we're in a position to do it. Again, when hungry come, needy come, or whatever, we need to be in a position that where we can help them. I saw a woman and sad. And again, I know there's people that manipulate, and there's phonies out there, and they're just ripping church people off. We need to be wise and all that. But she posted on Facebook, legitimate need, called several churches, went to several churches, and it wasn't even that much. And I know one of them, and this is a big city, would help her. I don't want to be like that. Yes, we need wisdom. Again, we were talking about it the other night. I've seen the fakers. Went to the Assemblies of God Church in Grove City for years, and we're eating at Fazoli's afterwards on Stringtown or whatever the main road is there. Had a guy with the son come in, and we had a big group of us at the table, giving a sob story. Oh, we're traveling out of money, need gas, da-da-da. Everybody at the table but us, and we're givers, gave this dude money. Then I watched him go to every other table. We're there probably an hour leaving a restaurant. I see him coming out of three restaurants on down the road. So you need to be wise. You need to be smart. You need to listen. But obey God when He says to do it. And the times that He said do it, He's blessed us. Now again, I understand He sees our motives in our hearts, and there's times even out of ignorance if we give or sow somewhere, I believe He can still bless it. But when we know better, we need to stop it. But church, God is wanting to multiply everything good, and that's of Him in each and every one of your lives. He's wanting to do the same thing in the Firehouse Church. One last scripture. I know we all know it. Most of you could probably quote it. Ephesians 3:20. Now unto who? Him. Who what? Is able to do what? Exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to what? The power, or His power, that works in us. Again, He's not way off yonder somewhere. Same anointing, the same glory that Jesus had, the same Holy Spirit that Jesus was filled with, led by, empowered by, we're filled with, led by, empowered by. And God will do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to His power that dwells and resides on the inside of us. But we got to be willing to do something. We got to believe God for it, church. We got to believe that God wants to multiply, that God wants to increase, that God wants to bless, that God wants to heal, that God's multiplying signs, wonders, healings, miracles. God's multiplying our cattle or your finances, whatever your needs are. He is a God of increase, a God of multiplication. Yes, in this nation and other nations, there's been times of recessions and depressions and all that. Never been a shortage in heaven. I don't believe there's ever a time Jesus went to the Father, hey, we need to chip off some of this gold off the streets up here because it's getting rough. There's no shortage in heaven. Where the lack comes in, obviously, lack of wisdom on our part. Being stingy or giving concern. But it's us limiting God. We need to take the lid off and stop limiting God and believe God for the supernatural. Believe God for the miraculous. Believe that God's multiplying. And where your finances are concerned, even if it's a little. Again, Jesus, some people think He don't care. He does. Jesus, when He was on this earth, was watching those that gave. And one particular offering, and it was the one woman that gave the smallest amount, but it was all she had. She's the one that got recognition from Him, not those that gave out of their abundance. So it isn't the amount. It's the faith, the obedience, doing what God wants you to do in the heart. Now, after we get off of Facebook and all that, we'll receive the offering. But I said at the beginning of the service, we've been fighting sickness and disease. A bunch of people have. We had Greg's sister and brother-in-law were over last night. They've been off and on for 3 months. There's junk all over. Well, it doesn't mean I got to receive it, keep it, and you don't either. Doesn't matter if it's a season or this, that, and all the other. I continue to be moved by what He said. He said in Exodus 15:26, and this is for you on Facebook as well, I am the God that healeth thee. Not I was the God that used to. I am the God that healeth thee. Psalm 103:3, and man, I'm feeling a whole lot better. I was dragging in the same way she was. This could have been a day one of y'all got a phone call. Hey, you're preaching today. Put on a CD or something. We both drug our rear ends in. But I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. I'm a soldier. Ah, we're here. Glory to God. But Psalm 103:3 said, he forgives me of all my sins. Does he? And heals me of all my diseases. 1 Peter 2:24, he himself bore my sins on his body on the tree so that I may die to sins, live for righteousness, by whose stripes I am healed. Jeremiah 30:17, God made this word jump alive to me, and I've shared it when I was in the hospital with a blood clot. Jeremiah 30:17, I'm restoring health to you and healing you of all your wounds. Some of y'all need to take that. I'm restoring health to you. Where are you going, woman? I'm going to need you. He called his wife woman. What? Okay. At least you didn't need wheeled out. But Jeremiah 30:17, he said, I'm restoring health to you and healing you of all your wounds. Doesn't matter your wounds. Well, I've had this injury, this wound for 20 years. I don't care. Again, I'm still praying. He'll watch this. Usually does. Pastor Kevin Bishop. God healed his knee here. One of the revival services. Well, he's helping his brother, his sons with some ice in the driveway. Or one of his sons fell. He'd already had surgery on his arms in a sling. And he tried to protect his son from getting hurt. Tore his knee all up. And I know he's preaching today. Still arm, wing in a sling, and a knee. I was kind of making fun with him this week. Because he does the Facebook Live. He had a sling on, had a knee brace. I said, what are you going to have next week? A neck brace?
You're having a healing service. Yes.
Doesn't matter. Heal you of all your wounds, restoring health to you. So it doesn't matter what sickness, disease you may be fighting today. Again, we're standing on God's word. That the healer is still in the house. The healing power of God is still available to each and every one of us. And whatever sickness, disease you may be fighting, whatever injury, that's heal you of all your wounds. Whatever injury, God can. He's more than able to restore it and to heal it. And I'm believing God for multiplication of healing, signs, wonders, and miracles. Again, as I've said before, he's not a little dabble do you God. He just didn't feed the multitudes. There was plenty left over. I'm tired of people just, well, my ear got healed, but I still got all these other issues. No, I want it all. Amen. Whether it comes all in one service or not, doesn't matter. But I'm contending for it all. I'm contending for it all for me. And again, I'm a whole lot better than I did. I'm back there once and hacked something up. Or thought I hacked something. And I looked down a few minutes later, there's a big wad on my wrist. I know that's nasty. I'm like, ew. I get them devils out piece by piece. So if you're here this morning, you need a healing in your body. Again, we're not going to drag it out, but you need a healing in your body. And several of you raised your hand. I don't care whether it's you're fighting sickness, disease, wounds, injuries, or whatever. We're going to pray for you, minister to you, and believe God for the multiplication and the increase of health and healing in your body. Amen?
Amen.
And after that, just for good measure, because I just like kicking the devil in his gumby mouth, because he's toothless. He goes around like a roaring lion. See, he ain't got no teeth. He's gumby. He's a gumby lion. So we may just pray for more fire as well. If you need healing in your body, just make your way up here and we're going to minister to you. Come on down. Price is right. It's free. Glory to God.
I want to share this real quick because it's kind of funny. I sit here many times and I just am so fired up with what the Lord speaks through me. I just want to run, but I hold back.
You finally did.
I hold back.
And you finally did.
And I heard them. I was sitting there. I was holding back. And I heard the Lord say, run! And I started running as I was running around. I was like, my thoughts were, I feel so silly. And the Lord said, are you willing to look silly for me?
Yes, come on.
You don't know what I'm doing in your bodies as you run.
That's right.
And then he said, do not let the enemy hold you to your seat.
That's right.
When he's telling you to go
do
up.
Something.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
And again, even when somebody feels led to run, it ain't running just for the sake of running.
Right.
There's a purpose in it.
That's right.
I read a story once in a book of a man, and he was talking about supernatural and all that, but
He was preaching in the service, whatever, in the middle of the service. Mine would look horrible if I tried it. So God won't tell me to do that. But the Lord told him in the middle of his preaching to do a cartwheel. In the middle of his preaching, he did a cartwheel. Turned out there was a man way back in that service that was ready to commit suicide. And said, God, don't y'all get goofy on me. God, if you're real, if you can do something with my life, if you really exist the way he's preaching and people are saying, have that man do a cartwheel. Fortunately, that preacher heard from God, did a cartwheel. That guy got saved, gave his heart to the Lord. So I challenge you to just mention that to me for a minute. I felt like jumping on and running for us. Do it. Jump on and run.
Amen.
You never know what your obedience will do for somebody else. That same way, like salvation altar calls, all it takes is the one or two to come down.
That's right.
Others will follow.
Else.
And I've seen it the same way. And altar calls like this. Again, if you're sitting there fighting junk, why are you going to keep sitting there fighting? God can touch me here. Yes, he can touch you there. But if he's wanting to touch you here, and you stay there, then you can just leave out of here, you old sick man. No, come down and receive what God has
you
for you.
You can have it.
Rest of you, stand to your feet. Stretch forth your hands in your faith towards Jesus. Need healing. I don't always do this because some people get all religious. Think you always got to anoint with oil. You don't always have to anoint with oil, but I do it when God says. It's a symbolic of the Holy Spirit.
I heard him say that a while ago. They're going to anoint you with oil.
There you go. Praise God.
Are you sick among you?
Yes.
All the owners of the church. They'll anoint you with oil and pray the prayer of faith, and I will deliver you.
We just command this itching, whatever the cause of it is, to stop now in the name of Jesus. We rebuke it, we resist it, whether it's some allergic reaction or just some devil to hell. Loose this man in the name of Jesus, and we command this itching, this rash, to depart from John's body in the name of Jesus. Father, we continue to thank you and praise you for quick healing, God. These gums in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you,
Lord. Thank you, Lord. Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
The doctor says I have a little something torn here, and I don't accept it.
All right. Mark, can we stand on Jeremiah 30:17?
Yes.
If you're restoring health to Sally
yes.
and healing
yes.
her of all the wounds, so just restore this knee in the name of Jesus. Lord, I know what you've done in my knees. You can do it for her. So just restore the tendon, restore the cartilage, restore the meniscus, whatever needs restored in her knee, God. You restore it. And just remove all pain.
Thank you, Lord. Okay. Yes, good. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we just thank you for your continued strength.
Well, this shoulder.
Continue to heal this shoulder. Loosen it. Put it back where it belongs in Jesus' name. Total health.
Oh, no.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Yes.
Fire caught up here. Good old knees. Lord, I just command this knee to be healed in the name of Jesus. I command all pain to go. Restore from any tear, any injury. But I thank you for restoring this knee. 100% whole and healed in Jesus' name. No more pain. No more pain. Totally healed in Jesus' name.
Yes. Restoration.
Curse this virus in the name of Jesus. We command these spots, these warts to go. But Jesus, you are the healer. You said healing is the children's bread. We're all sons and daughters, but this is a child, Jesus. So we thank you for your grace, for your mercy, for your healing power flowing through her body right now, removing this virus and every symptom, side effect of it. And we speak healing to her brother as well in Jesus' name. We thank you for removing this from her body. We just thank you for giving her peace, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the name of Jesus, we continue to command these hormones to line up in the name of Jesus. We've been redeemed from the curse. She's redeemed from the curse of the law, and we're under grace, and we receive it all by faith. I thank you for lining these hormones up in the name of Jesus. I command every cell, every organ, every tissue, every part of her body to line up with these balanced Christ in the name of Jesus. I guess the Lord wants to go there if you just want a fresh touch of His presence and of His fire. Come on now. Pray. He's pouring it out. Dripping on. If you got to leave, you're free to go in Jesus' name. If you got to go and you need to get an offering, the offering bags are back there. There's offering envelopes in them. They're on the table.
The Lord still wants to pour out. There's more of this healing.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for some fresh fire. I thank you, Father, for peace. I thank you for wisdom. I thank you for doing what only you can do. She needs a miracle in these areas. Lord, you're more than able to do it. I said you're more than able to do it. So I ask you, Lord, to do exceedingly abundantly above all that Cheryl's asking, thinking, or imagining. Right now and this year and in the future in Jesus' name. The Lord, just fill her up. Fill her up. Fill her up with your presence, with your power, with your strength, with your joy. Your word says the joy of the Lord is my strength. So I just release joy to her in Jesus' name. It's your joy. It's not my joy. It's not man's joy. It's your joy. You said you wanted our joy to be full. So fill her with your joy, Jesus. Hallelujah.
It's on fire.
Best of you that are just go shop. Thank you for fresh fire. Fresh fire. Fresh fire.
I just bind every attack of the enemy. Every attack against her body, every attack against that car, the finances, saying you're a liar, there's no truth in you. You're a trespasser, you have no rights to this body, you have no rights to your finances. I release peace, multiplication and increase in every area of her life, finances, family, in Jesus' name. Lord, I thank you for fresh fire. Fresh fire. And a dose of joy. Never stop the pattern of joy. I said, never stop the pattern of joy.
Extra dose.
Oh.
Drink.
I praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Your body right now, that you'd be healed whole and complete from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. Again, we curse every symptom, side effect of cancer, depression, oppression, anxiety, fear, arthritis. Arthritis has got to go in Jesus' name. Suicidal thoughts got to go in Jesus' name. And Lord, we just release your fire right now upon each and every one that's wanting more of your fire, more of your presence, more of your glory. Touch them, fill them now in Jesus' name. Pastor Kevin, we continue to speak to your right knee. Be healed, be healed, be healed. Pain go. For that left bicep to be healed up, restored from surgery as well. We give you, Father, all the praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all.
I didn't feel like I was sitting on it.